HKI 2020 Reinforcement Learning for Intelligent Transportation Systems workshop. My name is Liam Paul. I'm going to be chairing this session and the next session. It's my distinct honor and pleasure to introduce our next speaker. Alex Bayen is the Lau Cho Professor of Engineering at UC Berkeley, a professor of both electrical engineering and computer science and civil and environmental engineering. He's currently the director of the Institute of Transportation Studies and a faculty scientist in mechanical engineering at the Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory. He received the engineering degree in applied mathematics from École Polytechnique France in 1998, his master's and PhD in aeronautics and astronautics from Stanford in 99 and 2004, respectively. He was a visiting researcher at NASA Ames Research Center from 2000 to 2003, and January 2004 through December 2004. He also worked as the research director of the Autonomous Navigation Laboratory at the Laboratoire de Recherche Balistique et Aérodynamique, Ministère de la Défense Vernon, France, where he holds the rank of major. Very excited to hear what he's gonna discuss with us today. The title of his talk is Circles Congestion Impact Reduction via CAV in the Loop Energy Smoothing. Alex, thanks so much, and take it away.
Thank you so much for the introduction, Liam, and the invitation, Tony. I love being introduced by Quebecois friends because this probably is the only place in the world where it makes sense to say Polytechnique France, and that's a good opportunity for me to wave and say hi to our comrades, Polytechnique students in Quebec. So thank you so much for the invitation. I'm really excited to be here. I want to emphasize the fact that I'm presenting the work of a lot of people. So it's not just my research group at UC Berkeley, but it's really a big consortium. You can see most of the logos here. And maybe to get started with that, I'm going to spend a few minutes talking what Circles is about and who we are. And then we're going to go into the more scientific core of the presentation, starting with traffic modeling, energy modeling, and then going into the reinforcement learning, which I assume is kind of part of the interest for this conference here. So who are we? We're a consortium of five universities and now three automakers, growing in size almost every month. The lead campus is UC Berkeley, but we're working with University of Arizona, Professor Sprinkle, recently moved to Vanderbilt with Professor Work. Rutgers with Professor Piccoli and Temple with Professor Siebold. And of course, lots of different partners, in particular DOTs. The TDOT, the Tennessee DOT, is a particularly impressive partner. You'll see why in a minute. They're building that gigantic test bed we're using for the work. But of course, the California Department of Transportation is also a big asset in our organization. So the work is really work done by students on the five campuses, as well as people at Toyota, and soon Nissan and GM. So in one slide, what is it we're trying to do? We're trying to smooth traffic with a small percentage of level two-ish, level three-ish enabled CAVs. So in other words, what if you had control over 2, 3, 4, 5% of vehicles with some level of automation too? Could you improve not only the efficiency of these vehicles, but could you also improve the efficiency of the overall traffic flow? And it's not science fiction, because if you go in some places in the Bay Area, you'll see some places have over 5% of Teslas driving today. And Tesla, just to name one particular brand, has complete has even more automation than we need to do what I'm going to present today. So what I'm presenting here is really not science fiction. It's something that can be done with most, I would say, advanced vehicles coming out of production for many automakers today, which is why you see several automakers being part of our team, because they're really excited about what we're doing. So more specifically, we're not trying to solve the congestion problem. That's a different problem. We're not going to remove traffic jams. That's not what we do. We're working with roughly constant throughput, constant travel time, but we're improving the flow efficiency of the freeway by essentially removing stop and go waves. And stop and go waves are things that I make the assumption many of you have already experienced. You stop, you go, you stop, you go. At the end, you have an average speed. If you had gone the average speed the whole way, you'd have incurred the same travel time, you'd have incurred the same throughput as a freeway, but you would have saved a lot of energy, and safety would have been also much better, because most of accidents happen in braking situations. So essentially, we try to transform what you see on the left. These are time-space diagrams. I'm going to explain that later, where you see these stripes here, which are waves, into something which you see on the right, which is much smoother. And our goal is that we would like to demonstrate next year that with less than 5% of controlled vehicles, you could improve the overall freeway efficiency by up to 10% for everybody on that freeway, which you can imagine with large freeways and five lanes carrying up to 2,000 vehicles an hour is a lot of GHG emission reductions as well as energy savings. Specifically, the locations and you know circumstances in which these things happen are phantom jams, sometimes referred to as jammitants or stop-and-go waves. You can see two examples on the left in Germany and the right in Atlanta. And essentially, you see these vehicles stop and going more or less, like you see the zoom on the left now, and these waves propagating backwards with really no good reason for it. So the notion is, with flow smoothers, level 2 enabled calves, could you stop that? Could you shave these oscillations? To do that, there's a bit of traffic modeling involved, but it's interesting too, because the reinforcement learning part I'm going to talk about kind of bypasses that. So let's start with that. Part of what our team does consists in building micro simulation models that are used in the reinforcement learning loop as a kind of model-free approach. And by model-free, I mean there is a model. You can see what it looks like right now on the right window. But the point is, the reinforcement learning I'm going to talk about does not know the details of that model. So the idea being, you know, the departments of transportation and public agencies are expert knowledge groups that know exactly how their traffic behaves, how lane changing behaves. They have modeled, they have OD demand models and have spent decades building these models. If we did inherit these models, could we use these models to learn? And could we use these models in the reinforcement learning loop to essentially improve the efficiency of traffic, which is why, in the present case, for the demonstration we're going to complete next year, we need to build these models ourselves because the models are not there. But the vision is that once this stuff is operational, it could be translated almost anywhere where there is such a model already. And many places have such models. So there's also a part which is energy modeling. Energy modeling is complicated because energy models have nonlinearities that are inherent to each different vehicles. They all have different aspects. If you model a truck, a bus, a pickup, or a sedan, they'd have very different models. So now we're not experts at energy modeling, but part of our team, in particular Toyota and Ken Butts and Benny Siebold from Temple, have spent a lot of time working with Argonne National Labs. And for those of you who are familiar with autonomy, that's one of the software we are using. Now, autonomy is very high fidelity software. So we use essentially autonomy to build reduced order models that can be integrated in a reinforcement learning loop. So in other words, you know, if you're going to do reinforcement learning, you can't really afford to spend too much time computing the reward function, because otherwise you're going to significantly slow down the performance of your algorithm. So if you did use a reduced order model, you could do that much more efficiently. And that's part of what the Temple team is doing. Essentially, the Temple team attempts to simplify the models in a way that they can be integrated in our reinforcement learning loop, as well as optimal control loops. So the way it looks like is we start with autonomy, which we work on very closely with people at Argonne that have the full-fledged, you know, high-dimensional model, anything from dynamometers to chassis and different gear models. And then essentially with semi-principal model, we get to an approach where we can get roughly the same models, but without in polynomial form, so that it's much easier to integrate into micro-simulation models. And the faculty in charge of this is Benny Siebold, and that's mostly his work. And that then comes into our reinforcement learning loops, which is what I'm going to talk about now. Now, for that, we have to kind of do a leap of back in history and go back to 1935. This is a historical picture of a person named Bruce Greenshields, who is historically credited for being the first person in the world to have actually measured a traffic jam. And that happened in 1935 at an agricultural festival somewhere in Ohio, where people were just piling up in front of the place where they were displaying some tractors and other agricultural equipment. And he was the first one to essentially draw a curve linking the average flow speed with the level of congestion. So think about it as a density, and that's then been called the Grinchfield flux function, which has been widely used in conservation laws and partial differential equation theory in the 50s, about 20 years later. The first such model came 20 years later in the form of the Lightill-Whitam-Richards PDE. And if you fast forward about 50 years, Sugiyama came up with that interesting experiment that you should see display on the screen here. And that's essentially an experiment in which in 2008, he asked people to drive in circles at a set speed of about 25 miles an hour. And with the only instruction that, you know, you should keep your distances, drive normally, don't crash. And what you see on that video happening right now is that after a few, not even minutes, like after 30 seconds, essentially the flow gets very unstable because people are not able to maintain their distances. And that kind of shows you the limit of a human controller. Like if you ask a human driver to accomplish such a task like this, it's not that obvious. And for those of you who served in the military, if you've tried to march for military parade, you know that. And there's a reason for it. I mean, there's delays in the system. There's lots of kinds of imperfections in perception. And that's essentially the source of the stop and go waves or phantom jams or jammitons that we're interested in. So now fast forward another 10 years, some part of our team, you see their pictures down there, did this experiment, revolutionary at the time. They essentially inserted a self-driving vehicle indicated by this black arrow into the oscillations of the ring. So they essentially replicated that experiment. Now, right now, it's oscillating because that car that you see with a white with a black arrow is actually driven by a human. When that arrow turns red in about 5 seconds, when I play again the movie, that means the pilot, the autopilot has been engaged. And what you will see is that that happens right now. And pretty quickly, the autopilot essentially manages to smooth the traffic. So this is, to our knowledge, the first historical instantiation of smoothing of shock and go waves, of course, in a contained environment. This was 22 vehicles. The algorithm running right now is called the follower stopper. We'll talk about this later. It's a principle-based controller. It's not RL. But it's remarkable because it actually enables the reduction of the energy consumption of that traffic by 42%. 42%, it's insane. And it's not modeled. It's actually collected from the canvases of through a BD2. So it's actually measured data. And the savings are quite astounding here because it's about, you know, 5% or 4% penetration rate is like one cav over, over 22 vehicles. So when the team did that in 2017, it really opened our eyes about the fact that in the context of mixed autonomy, the potentials of automation for energy smoothing and energy improvement are quite amazing. Now, a year later, student of mine, who is now a professor at MIT, Kathy Wu, did the following experiment. She programmed the same ring in Sumo, which you see now, and integrated a self-driving vehicle. That's the red vehicle. The only thing it can sense is the blue vehicle. It cannot sense the white vehicles. And right now it crosses the line, it just did, and it's gonna turn on an RL algorithm to smooth traffic. And what you see happening on the screen now is that after half a circle, essentially it's able to smooth the same traffic. Now, you're probably wondering now, why am I showing you a simulation of 2018 of something that was tried in the field in 2017? That's a good question. The reason is in 2017, when they did the experiment, that was a principle-based controller that had a model of the entire ring. What you're looking at now is the result of an RL algorithm that has no idea how the white vehicles behave, that only knows the distance between the right vehicle, the red vehicle and the blue vehicle, and is essentially trying to optimize a combination of average speed and fuel economy. So essentially, the interesting part is that all the modeling I've discussed since 1935 has essentially been ignored in that approach. All it required to make that same algorithm work is to be able to train an RL controller in a black box simulations. It's really model-free RL. And that also achieved, you know, very comparable results, about 49% in improvements, I believe. And so it's interesting if you think about it from a historical perspective, because Essentially, there's been about 10,000 articles to model instability, traffic, propagation of waves, hyperbolic PDEs, you name it. Now, after 2008, there have been about 1,000 articles focused on energy stability and improvement since that first Sugiyama experiment. And it took one article to redo the same in simulation, okay, give or take, with no models, essentially ignoring the thousands of papers written before. So that, to us, was really eye-opening because it showed that in many ways, even though the answer is not to take everything we've done for a century and throw it in the garbage, reinforcement learning provides alternatives to modeling-based approach that are quite surprising. So in the rest of the talk, when I talk about the reinforcement learning algorithms we've developed, the type of color scheme we'll use to explain what we're doing is always going to be the same. A red car will be connected, an automated vehicle with some level of automation and some level of communication, depending on the setting I explain who communicates with whom. And the only thing it will be able to sense is what the blue vehicles, usually vehicles around it, because you can have cameras and sensors, and in some circumstances, vehicles that are not around you, say if these vehicles were connected and were broadcasting data. Let's start with this interesting case. This is a double ring. The red car can sense the cars in the back. And you can see right now it's doing an interesting thing, is behaving like a real jerk, switching back and forth between the two lanes to prevent the people in the back from passing it. But as a matter of fact, it kind of stabilizes the double ring, which otherwise would also incur these oscillations, which I described before. What's amazing about this is that it does not have a lane change model. It does not have an IDM or a CFM model for each of the white vehicles. It's just doing it by improving its reward function. And you could argue, well, okay, there's no big deal here. It's just reproducing what's been known from the police academy a long time ago when you do snail operations. What's interesting is that it discovered it like without a model. So it's kind of a form of emergent behavior of mixed autonomy that is obviously reminiscent of what's done in the practice, but was done just in isolation. Of course, more complex scenarios with intersections can be investigated. And so if you think about the most inefficient way of handling an intersection, the best way to do that is to essentially have everybody stop and accelerate at the intersection, which is, I think, the way that minimizes throughput and maximizes energy consumption. If you try the same algorithm as I have shown before in that setting, what you see is that it's, well, I'm going to narrate it, but that's not something it did on purpose. It essentially figured out the right speed at which to drive so that the intervehicular spacing of the vehicles behind it would adjust themselves exactly to the length of a snake that spans half of the 8-figure. I just narrated that for you, but obviously, again, it has no idea what a snake is. It has no idea what model the blue cars, it can sense all of them, that's a bit of a trick, are doing. Essentially, it just... It's another emergent behavior, a form of platooning that it discovered through this optimization of the reinforcement learning loop. And so essentially you could argue, well, it kind of rediscovered platooning, because if you look at the first time-space diagram, which represents the trajectories of the position, so essentially you have car coming westbound, cars coming southbound, and you alternate south, west, south, west. It figured it could stack a lot more vehicles by having everybody go south, then everybody go west, then everybody go south again, and all these oscillations just go away. So quite astounding, again, reinforcement learning-based emergent behavior. If I look at this kind of slightly more complex situation now, where I have a form of an 8-figure with an intersection, and if you try to maximize the throughput at that intersection, again, this kind of politeness approach where people go first based on first arrival at the stop, is probably one of the most inefficient ways of handling that intersection. However, because of the routing patterns that are essentially putting some vehicles on the longer loop and some vehicles on the shorter loop, it's not obvious what that policy should be. And so when I play the same outcome of the same algorithm, and you can see the red vehicle is sensing some blue vehicles here and there, it's really not obvious what it's doing now. Right now it's acting as a traffic light, it's stopping, and then it's going, it lets some cars go, and then it's going to stop again. So I cannot even find a plausible story that I could tell you about what it's doing, because it's come up with some form of slowing down behavior, but it's not something that I can describe in a short statement and intuitive statement. So in a sense, a way where the learning has superseded the ability of the human to rationalize what it's seeing. Another interesting thing you can do with this is transfer learning, where you learn in one setting and you deploy in another setting. So here, you learn in the ring. So you learn with multiple smoothers. It's a bigger ring. And then you try to see if you deploy that policy into a situation it has never seen before, such as a merge, like here, where it can only see some vehicles that are connected again together. So the algorithm works well. That's the nominal setting. The nominal setting is you're injecting vehicles inside that system. And over time, that injection is going to create back propagating waves that are progressively moving upwards, or I would say upstream in the, that means in the back, in the system. And you can see these waves happening as we speak. You can see these waves back propagating now. I know the visualization is sometimes a bit deficient over Zoom, but you can probably see that happening. So it's essentially a case of back propagation of these waves that is generated by the perturbation, that the flow smoothers will handle. I see a question here, which I'm going to read. The optimal policy seems conditional on traffic density. I assume that the traffic density is the same during the RL agent training and the test time. How does the model work when the traffic density is changed? So the answer is yes, this assumption is correct. For the algorithm to work, you need to make the assumption that the traffic density is similar in training and in deployment, which means that when you deal with real situation, you have two alternatives, which are complicated to reconcile. Either you can make the assumption that the deployment will be in similar condition. That's kind of cheating, and that works. Another way is to train in a lot of different density scenarios. But when that happens, it's complicated because the RL will try to maximize the reward in expected value, which means it might not be optimal in the specific regime you choose. Say you choose over a family of densities, it includes your actual density when you're going to deploy in the field. When you're deploying in the field, now the RL algorithm is not necessarily representative of optimizing the situation in that density, but over the distribution of densities over which it learned. And that's something we have not completely figured out how to handle, other than by quote cheating, which is essentially assuming the day of you can sense the conditions and make sure that, well, it kind of will choose amongst the policy that is the most relevant. So it is a real difficulty. It's not, and we're still considering this as an open problem at the present time. But in that case, the conditions are nearly identical. And so what you will see is that when you inject the vehicles inside the stream, after a while, the red vehicles, which can sense all the blue vehicles, so that it assumes some level of communication, react to it. That car now that you see my mouse circling over has essentially stopped for a little bit and is essentially reaccelerating to reintegrate inside the stream in a way that is compatible with the injection of cars. Here's another one that does exactly the same. So you could say here again, the rationalization is you kind of taught a car to become a red traffic light, which is kind of an interesting, you know, simple way to think about this. But if you look at the actual interpretation of this, essentially, you know, so again, looking in this kind of time-space diagram format, you have the trajectories of the vehicles, you have the position, and what happens is every time you inject a vehicle at that merge, that at this post mile here, so this is position, this is time, and that injection of a car creates that wave that propagates backwards that you see my pointer moving over, and that's where the efficiency comes in. Every time you have an injection, you have a wave that is created, sometimes sustained, sometimes not sustained, but either way, bad. And what the transfer learning does is, because of the fact that the vehicles are connected, when the car entering here enters and can sense that slowdown, instead of trying to catch up as fast as possible, which is the natural human behavior, which creates that instability, instead it preventively breaks down in order to reconnect with that stream right at the point of the merge. So in other words, this is kind of an anticipative behavior that it has learned in the ring and is displaying in the merge. And again, enabled by the fact that it can sense that slowdown ahead of it by the connection of the blue cars. So that was kind of an inspiring start for us because it enabled us to kind of see how we could potentially push what's been done on the ring into the real field. And at that time, Aboudi Kraidye and Eugene Vinitsky, two UC Berkeley students who work on the project, started to run penetration studies where they wanted to understand how many vehicles would you need to push onto a single lane to essentially smooth traffic and achieve these 10% energy savings. And it was pretty reinforced. It was pretty encouraging to see that with 10% AV, you could almost smooth these waves. Not quite the objectives we had for the DOE at that time, but very encouraging. And this was picked up by the news, including Science Magazine. So we're pretty excited. So that was the beginning of the next phase, which is, okay, so now if we're going to try it on the real freeway, how would we do it? This is a microsimulation model of the I-210 freeway in Los Angeles. That model was built by the Connected Corridors team that works for District 7 of the California Department of Transportation. And right now, what you see in that movie, I'm going to pause it, you see red cars and white cars. The red cars are CAVs, but they're not running the policy. They're just driven by humans. That's essentially a warm-up that creates these waves that you can see. The waves are back-propagating from the outflow and filling that square, which you see blown up in that little window here. In about 20 seconds, you'll see some cars turning blue. And at that point, that means the red cars can sense other cars, the blue cars, and have turned on their controllers. So the red cars will be controlling as soon as you see the cars turning blue. When that happens, the waves that you see, I just paused the movie again, will start to be smooth. And I know that's difficult to see over Zoom because of the stroboscopic effect, but imagine you have waves going back and forth and back and forth. You will see these waves being smooth. So right now the cars have just turned blue. You can see there's blue cars here, 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 here. That means these cars can be sensed by the red cars, and the red cars are using that information in terms of deploying the flow smoother algorithms that I've seen here. You might be able to see this over Zoom, but now the flow in that box is a lot smoother. There's no significant difference in terms of throughput or travel time. As I said, we're not fixing congestion. We're just improving flow efficiency. But as a result, the smoothers have essentially enabled to shave the stop and go waves of that section. So for a while, before we could deploy things in Tennessee, we did most of our training in this model, mostly because this model has been calibrated for the DOT, and it's a pretty recognized model in California. So in a sense, it provided a lot of legitimacy in terms of showing that things would work in the field. So let me just continue to the next slide. So now we have these algorithms, and the real question is, how are we going to make this work in the field? So over the last 5 years at Berkeley, we built a framework called Flow. And Flow was historically the first integration of three things, state-of-the-art commercial microsimulators. We had two at the time, MSUN, which is a commercial product now owned by Siemens, Sumo, which is a counterpart in the open source world, RL libraries, RLLit and RL Lab, some of which came out of Berkeley, and all of this running on AWS. We were very happy because MSUN, so Siemens, actually built the first build of MSUN for cloud. I mean, essentially, MSUN was a pretty traditional architecture until recently that only worked on dedicated servers. So for that purpose, they built a cloud version, and we were the first to use it in the 210 model, and that was really nice. The whole framework I'm showing here is open source. Anybody on the call is free to download it. If you don't want to pay for the MSUN license, just use Sumo. It works equally well with Sumo. And you can train all your policies in Sumo. If you have inherited a Sumo model from anything, an intersection in Berlin, a freeway in Timbuktu, or an arterial network in Brasilia, you should be able to use that Sumo model to train your algorithms on it. Now at Berkeley, we also have created something that we are going to open source as well, but right now are only using internally because it's not ready for open source. Is essentially we have interfaced Sumo, Flow, and all these RL libraries with a database that we can use inside our leaderboard. And that's a way for us to benchmark different algorithms before they go into a pipeline that is used to deploy in the field. And we hope to open source that at some point once we have the time to do it, so that you know, we could potentially come up with some kind of nice version of a Mujoko of traffic, if you will, where different algorithms could be benchmarked on the same traffic situations. If you visit us or work with us, you'll see, so the way the dashboard looks is like you see here. Essentially, we check in algorithms, and then there's a family of scenarios the algorithms are tested on. It produces the time space diagrams you see here, and it can then pop up scores on how well the algorithm is doing for a specific situation. So it's kind of an instantiation or early instantiation, if you will, of kind of how we can benchmark algorithms against each other. Now, we've now worked with several automakers to migrate this to the field. Our most advanced work is with Toyota, and I want to really acknowledge the work of Professor Sprinkle here at Vanderbilt, now before that, University of Arizona, together with Ken Butts from Toyota. And essentially, we're using RAV4s that are essentially accessible to us through the CAN bus and the LitPanda interface. And so with that, we can essentially overwrite the stack of ROS and essentially superimpose our controller on top of the ACC. So think about your car, you know, you have some form of automation by engaging the ACC. Imagine we can override that and essentially access the same type of automation through the ACC, and that's how we're doing longitudinal control. So we have a variety of settings in which we've tried that in Nashville, around Vanderbilt. Two of the vehicles are at Berkeley, were at Berkeley and are now there. And then we've essentially tried this in the field in Nashville. This is John, the John Sprinkle, the PI at Vanderbilt, who is doing that. And you know, in the process of essentially, I'm going to just stop this sound here release. Just a second.
The car's going to start to go a little bit here. Okay. And then I'll go a little bit forward, push it up. So now it's accelerating.
So the voice you hear is Matt Bunting, and it's essentially, this was one of the first time we were accessing the ROS interface through the joystick he's showing here, which essentially enables us to have a direct way to drive the car remotely. So now you can see how that part of the pipeline connects to the RL. So essentially there's a whole series of tests we have to go through before we are comfortable to migrate the algorithms to the field. So first, we have a software co-simulation, then we migrate to Gazebo. Gazebo is this very nice high resolution environment we can use for just assessing how well the algorithm does. And then at some point we try the algorithms in the field. Now, it turns out that RL policies can be very unpredictable, and we're not comfortable deploying them directly into the vehicles. So if you remember the follow or stopper algorithm that I showed for the very, very first ring I demonstrated in Arizona, the 2017 ring, essentially, the way we do the migration of the policy inside the RAV4 is the policy will determine a target speed, and that target speed is filtered through the follower stopper. Because the follower stopper is a semi-principal algorithm we can use for safety analysis, and we're actually quite comfortable that it performs at the required level of safety. So if the RL provides too aggressive brakes as well as too aggressive accelerations, we want to prevent that. The accelerations can be pretty scary, actually, because of the vehicle in the front, but the brakes are also pretty scary because that could create a backward collision with the vehicle in the back. So that's something we also want to prevent. So everything I've said here has to be taken with a grain of salt, in that when we're teaching the algorithms to achieve specific goals, they're actually trained through the follower stopper. In other words, there's two ways to do it. Either you just train in the free and then filter out the command through the follower stopper, or you could also embed the policy in the follower stopper and feed that to the reward function and then train that in that way. And we do both. And it reduces the stress a lot when we go to the field, because again, the RL can learn to do very aggressive things which are not necessarily comfortable for the human.
Okay, everything works.
Now, we also finally have a test bed, and this is really exciting. I wish I had more recent results, because we were doing tests 2 weeks ago in Tennessee, and I don't have the results to show yet because we're still processing them. But we have a very exciting test bed in Tennessee that was put together and instrumented by the Tennessee Department of Transportation. And it's really a good way for us to acknowledge their leadership because they've been really fantastic in instrumenting that testbed. So the testbed is I-24. And the way to think about this is the following. For those of you who have experience with traffic data, you might remember the NGSIM data about two decades ago. This is what I'm showing here. The NGSIM data was probably for two decades the best visualization data there was in terms of, you know, high resolution video camera data for a pretty complex freeway, the I-80 in Emeryville, showing lane changes, a lot of heterogeneity in the vehicle class, and essentially a second by second trajectory of about 500 meters stretch of freeway. These cameras were mounted on top of our buildings about 20 years ago by some courageous postdocs. It's actually quite scary, and produced this data that's been cited thousands of times and used all over the world because for a while, this is really the best data there was. So you should think about what we're building in Tennessee under Dan Work's leadership as kind of the next generation of this. So this movie here shows the poles they're erecting along the I-24 freeway to collect that data. You can see these poles are quite gigantic. They're packed with six pack of data. Here's the first pole coming up. They're packed with a six pack omnidirectional video camera that provides essentially full coverage of a stretch of freeway about every 500 meters. That's about how far apart they will be. These first three poles are the first stretch that was essentially erected about 6 months ago or 9 months ago now, I guess. That we are going to use for post-processing of the data. Now, this is not going to be used for real-time because it's too hard to do real-time machine vision-based analysis of the freeway and then plug that back into the system. But that gives you a sense of the data you get. And that's certainly amazing for us to monitor the evolution of the waves. It's unclear how precise acceleration can be computed from these. We're still starting with that. And obviously visual odometry is challenging. So extracting acceleration from video data will be problematic. So it's an open problem now, but for what we're doing in terms of flow smoothing, it's actually already extremely valuable. We hope that by next summer, when we do our experiment with up to hopefully 100 level 2 enabled calves, we will have 40 of these poles erected along the 24 freeway. Right now we have three, and the Tennessee Department of Transportation is working very, very aggressively to essentially deploy the rest in time for our experiment. So going into the future, you know, it's kind of an interesting situation here. You take the high-end vehicles coming out of the factory these days. I mean, think of your favorite brand, which has some level of automation. Some places in the world have already over 5% of people driving these vehicles at specific congestion times and freeways. These vehicles have an ability to sense a lot of things around them, in particular the vehicle in front, obviously, for navigation purposes. So when we're building these algorithms in the flow framework, one thing we're cognizant of is like, you know, what kind of architecture will be available for this to work? And the simplest architecture is really the poor man's architecture, where essentially nothing can be transmitted. I mean, even though technically you could transmit over 5G or the cell network some information, at least from high end to high end, but essentially the worst case scenario is essentially each vehicle is running a decentralized, not connected policy. So something it's kind of learned and it's now applying offline and maybe transmitting, you know, low latency or some latency, low bandwidth data through the cell network that could be maybe used for something in real time. And I think, so that can happen today. I mean, every high-end vehicle like the Tesla has a chip, a GSM chip that will transmit that data or upload some data. And even if you don't force connectivity, that can happen today. So I think that's kind of the nominal anatomy of what that NCAR test will be, the one we're running next year. Obviously, in an ideal world, we would like something slightly better. And this is, again, not science fiction. This is something that can happen. What if now that communication with each of the vehicles was bidirectional? So again, maybe low bandwidth, high latency or medium latency, but bidirectional. And then an ability to do some model running in real time on the cloud that could probably address some of the questions that Liam raised earlier, is like, what if the condition changes and then maybe there's a better selection of the policy that can adapt to the changing traffic conditions. We did some really scary experiments 2 weeks ago in Nashville, and over the course of 20 minutes, condition on the 24 can change radically. So obviously there's a relevance in having the ability to transmit some sensing data. And really all you need is a scrape of Google traffic, because Google traffic has a travel time, you can scrape it. And from travel time, you can infer a rough estimate of density, especially if you have video data to back it up. So, you know, it's not crazy. You don't need to transmit a huge amount of data to enable that second paradigm. Obviously, in the dream paradigm, you'd have high bandwidth, low latency, V2V, V2X, V2I, V2 anything you want. And in that case, okay, it's paradise, because now you can run things on the cloud really fast, feed it back and whatnot. That's not going to happen right away. And that's certainly not going to be available to the driving public or any team right away, because even though it is possible to put this with 5G maybe on some high-end vehicles, I mean, I don't think there's a lot of incentives in the automotive sector today to have this. So I think this is more of an aspiration. Maybe in 10 years it will be common, but I don't think we should expect that this is possible in the next 10 years. But I think it's also motivational, because I think it will come at some point, and it will probably arrive in some regions of the world which are more automation friendly and maybe also have higher average level of income because of the way this maps into what people buy. So I think it's also something that is worth preparing for, even though it's not happening tomorrow. So where are we going with that? We're in our second year of this DOE project. You've seen the DOE, US Department of Energy logo prominently displayed in this presentation quite often. We're extremely grateful and honored to be supported by the US Department of Energy, as well as the National Science Foundation. This year, this started in 2016, even before I was involved. This year, we just completed a 14-car test where some of the 14 cars had some level of automation. We'll publish that pretty soon, and we'll try to show some results pretty soon. So hopefully in a few weeks, I'll be able to show more. This was completed 2 weeks ago on the I-24 in Nashville, Tennessee. This was pretty stressful because, again, that traffic is quite brutal, but we are very excited to see that the algorithms function the way we thought they would. We were able to do some flow smoothing. We still have some work to do to achieve our 10% goals, but it's very, very promising. So we're now engaged with three automakers, Toyota, Nissan, and GM, to complete a much bigger test. So aspirationally 100 vehicles, but okay, we understand the logistics of running. I've run 100 vehicle test in my life about 12 years ago, and this is hard. So this is aspirational. We don't know how many we will be able to put on the road next year, but we just put 14 this year. So we hope to do have some higher number next year and be able to collect a lot of data. The aspiration is that we will not only publish the algorithms, they'll be open source, but we'll also publish the result of their operations on the freeway and make all of this open source ultimately, so that the community can play with it, with the aspiration that there is a good policy angle there too. If you can demonstrate flow smoothing, and if you can demonstrate that this saves 10% energy in places which have recurring congestion with stop and go waves, the implication on GHG are huge. That means that states might be willing to fund this in the form of an enablement that comes in some high-end vehicles or rebate. You might remember in 2006, the first Prius built by Toyota had access to diamond lanes in California. That was a way to push electrification. So it's not crazy that legal bills could incentivize this both on the driver side and the automaker side, which would boost vehicle sales and at the same time enable drivers to deploy this with some benefit. So it's not just an academic experiment. I think there's also an ideological aspiration of making this a next paradigm. And really, you could ask yourself, you know, when if you own a Tesla and if you drive that Tesla on I-280 in the Bay Area, will that car choose the posted speed limit, 65, or the social speed limit, which is 75? So the notion that there is actually some flexibility for an automaker to choose a target speed is a reality. So again, something not science fiction-y, something that could happen very quickly. This is my last slide. I promised 45 minutes to Tony, so I think I'm about to deliver in 1 minute from now. I really want to thank the whole team from the U.S. Department of Energy that has had faith in this work for the, from the very beginning, in particular Michael Berube, Dave Anderson, and Heather Croteau. Brett Arestigui, who has been our partner in crime in terms of putting all these agreements together. I want to thank the National Science Foundation, in particular Dave Corman, for his support. Many of the industry partners who have supported this work, in particular AWS, the BDD, Toyota, GM, Schlumberger, and Nissan, are greatly acknowledged, as well as the state of California with SB1, and of course the state of Tennessee, which has instrumented the I-24 that we're currently using for this work. Finally, I want to thank our auto partners, Toyota and GM, as well as Argonne. Argonne has been instrumental in helping us with these models and working together. I'm going to stop the screen share. I'd be very happy to take any questions. And again, I want to thank Tony and Liam for the invitation, for the ability to speak today. And I think we have a few minutes for questions if there is interest. Thank you.
Wow, incredible project, Alexandra. Very, very amazing how many different pieces there are that have all come together. So, please feel free to write questions in the chat or just raise your hand and you can take control of the of the thing. We have a question in the chat. How robust are the policies with regards to different behaviors in traffic, both in terms of having a single driver act significantly different and in shifts of the behavior distribution, for example, different locations?
Thank you for that question. The answer is not robust. This is, we had very scary experiments 2 weeks ago with lane changes, for example. I'll give you a perfect example of that. Our models were not trained efficiently enough with respect to lane changes. There's lane change models in micro simulators. They are polite, if you will, and not perfect. Sometimes they create crashes. And they were very different from what was happening on I-24 in Tennessee. People driving over the speed, the posted speed limit, and people cutting very aggressively in front of our vehicles that were leaving gaps. That led to controller disengagement. Essentially, the filter I described that essentially provides safety for our RL policy forced the RL to disengage because of very aggressive lane changes. And that's the perfect example of lack of robustness of our policies with respect to things we did not have in the training set. So this was really eye-opening for us. We kind of knew this was going to happen, but we did not know it would be that bad. That's kind of the difficulty of training in simulation and not in the real world. And so one way we've started to think about how we're going to solve that problem for next year is we have now collected hundreds of hours of data on I-24, and the data is precise enough that we can detect some lane changes and breaking into our lane, because essentially the radar will suddenly show a change in the distance with the forward vehicle, say from 200 meters to 50 meters because, or 10 meters because someone just cut in front of us. And so we will have to take this into account in our training. I think it's kind of a weakness of our training set. We knew that all along. This is the best we had. We have to find a better way to train with field data, which we have not done yet. And that's really that's difficult. Just no beating around the bush. I think you're putting your finger on something real and something difficult, and we're working on it. Tony, I see your hand up.
Go ahead, Tony.
I just typed in the chat box. So in the ring experiment at the beginning of your talk, I saw that there was one RL-based agent in there. I was wondering how does the system level performance change if you say increase the number of similar RL agents in the experiment? Do we have any idea about that?
Yes. So in the case of the ring experiment, so first, we have not studied that completely. In a sense, we have done some penetration studies. So working at various penetration rates for the different scenarios we've investigated. And usually what we find is that, if you increase the penetration rate enough, then at some point you hit a plateau and you really can do better than that. It's very heuristic. It's not grounded in theory, and it's empirical. We've also found some weird stuff we're not able to explain, is that if you keep increasing the penetration rate above where it plateaus, you sometimes make things worse. That's not good. We don't understand why, but that's something we have to figure out. So the way we use that is, okay, well, we would operate where it starts to get better and then just don't increase more. But that's something strange, because you would expect that with more agents, you would do better, but that's not always the case. It might be an artifact of how we are training the data. Now, for the specific case of the ring, it turned out that I do not think you can improve beyond what they've done with one vehicle. That's also something we've experimented on. The reason why I'm saying that for their experiment is that, as you saw, once you have smoothed the waves, essentially you've removed the acceleration. So your fuel efficiency becomes essentially the set speed. And at that point, it's the most efficient you can do at that speed. However, the efficiency of the smoothing algorithm depends on that set speed. In other words, if you're running at the ring super slow, in general, the oscillations won't be great. But if you start to run the ring at, say, 40 miles an hour, then it'll be terrible, because then the oscillations will go really fast. So there is also a flow parameter that will induce different badness level, if you will, of the waves. And so when you're thinking of penetration studies with rings, it's really also, there's a third axis of parameters to explore, which is the set speed. At the set speed, they run the experiment. One vehicle is enough. So one vehicle over 22 is roughly 20, so 5% penetration rate-ish. And that does the job. But the ring is a very, very idealistic case, right? And also the ring has some artifacts of, you know, it's kind of this infinitely periodic propagation, like a Fourier series. So it's not the same as a road, which is an open system with inflow and outflow. And the penetration rates that work well on the rings are below the ones that work well on these systems, because these systems are a lot more complex. But I think first, we have a paper coming out on penetration rates. So I'll try to include in my next presentations more results on that. I think penetration rates are really interesting. And I think that there's really certainly something to be said about having these penetration rate studies be run for every geography, as was indicated in some of the other questions. Efficiency of flow smoothing is very case dependent. So there might be places which need more higher penetration rate to proceed than others.
Thanks.
I also had another question. Do you notice a significant difference in performance between the case where the vehicle ahead is observable versus the case where, say, the vehicle ahead and the vehicle behind are both observable by the automated vehicle?
So we suspect there's difference, just because in general, the more you observe, the better you should be able to operate. We have not run specific studies with that, so I can't share any results I have. But there is something known in string stability, like going back to the Swaroop 1996 paper with Carl Hedrick, and before that, is that if you do propagate information to the next person in the back, you're unstable. But if you connect the last vehicle with the first, then you can re-achieve stability. It's kind of a known result of string stability. So I suspect that similar benefits will be observed if we did that. And I think I think you're putting your finger on also, as this adding one more axis with respect to Tony's question, is like, there's the settings of the experiment, there's the penetration, and there's also the communication architecture. Like, the more you enable communication, the more you should be able to smooth, because you can access the information downstream from you before it reaches you. So in the future, I think once we do more work on the 24, we should really try to have such an exploration. We don't have that yet. I suspect it would reveal that with more communication, you can do a lot more aggressive smoothing than we're currently planning.
And somehow your the actual control policy, like you have it filtered through this semi-principled controller that you're describing. So I'm imagining that there's some kind of RL agent, and like if there's no vehicle observed at all, then you have some like default control algorithm that you're running through that is just going to do like whatever velocity tracking. And so are you then able to account for the case from the RL side of the presence or absence of vehicles, depending on, because like I guess what I'm getting at is, it say you have like the ability to detect many vehicles that are nearby. Now you have this like problem of having a variable number of inputs to your RL algorithm, or that it becomes kind of more cumbersome to train and build an architecture for your RL algorithm with a variable number of inputs, as opposed to the case when you just care about the like presence or absence or the proximity of the vehicle in front. For example, I don't know if that's like an actual problem, but.
Yeah, no, it is a problem. So right now our algorithms essentially take intervehicular distance, intervehicular speed, and relative accelerations as inputs, just with the vehicle in the front. So because most of these variables you can measure pretty well with radar or any kind of sensing. Right now, the algorithm does not take the backward camera, the backward facing camera or radar or anything there is in the back into account, and does not take the lanes into account. And where it hurts is when a car cuts in front of you, then suddenly these variables change abruptly. So I think there's no beating around the bush. I think at some point we've got to take all of them into account. I think we've tried to contain ourselves to level 2 longitudinal because it's just a simpler problem. We don't want to have to deal ourselves with lane changes and whatnot. So, but we have to take that into account. And right now we did not anticipate that when that follower stopper filter is applied to the RL, you know, the RL is smart to understand that what it should do is it should slowly change the parameters of that filter to achieve optimality. So it learns that, and that's the way it should be. But of course, it does not work when suddenly the parameters change abruptly, because it's essentially like a hybrid switch where suddenly you're in the unsafe zone and it did not account for that. So as of 2 weeks ago, that has become an open problem we're deeply concerned about. And you know, it worked fine. I mean, it disengaged, it did exactly what it was super, nobody died, no accident, no nothing, not even a near miss, but it's just something we need to take into account.
Yeah, I guess the complexity of the real world always gets in the way somehow.
It does.
Alex, thanks again for the amazing talk. If there's any last questions, now is the time. Otherwise, I think we can thank Alex.
Thank you very much for having me. I'm really honored, and I wish I could come to Montreal because it's a really fun city. Hopefully there'll be opportunities in the future, but thank you, Liam. Thank you, Tony, and the whole committee for the invitation, and looking forward to another day in person.
Yeah, great. Okay, great. So with that, I guess we'll move on to the spotlight sessions. We're about 2 minutes fast, but I think that's okay. Seeing the authors already here, and I think somebody already made Runze co-host. So the first paper to present in the spotlight session is Pattern Transfer Learning for Reinforcement Learning in Order Dispatching. The authors are Runzi Wen, Sheng Zhang, Cheng Chun Shi, Shikao Luo, and Rui Song. And I understand that Runzi Wen is going to be presenting the paper. Do you want to share your screen and take it away?
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks so much for the introduction. Could you see my screen?
Yep.
Yeah, thanks. First of all, I would like to thank for the great discussion. Yeah, I learned a lot. And also thank for the opportunity to present our work. So today I will talk about our work on pattern transfer learning for reinforcement learning order dispatching This is joint work with Dr. Shen Zhang, Chenfeng Shi, Shikai Roy, and Ri Song. I guess nowadays everybody has experiments with these so-called ride-hailing platforms, such as Didi Chuxing, Uber, and Lyft. They hugely improve the transportation efficiency in our cities. And one of the central tasks to those platforms, the so-called online order dispatching problem, which essentially means from time to time, we will receive some order requests from our customers. And we also have some available drivers. We need to find a good policy or good algorithm to assign those orders to those drivers to maximize some business metric of interest. For example, the customer experience or some profits. And nowadays, starting from the seminal paper of Xu 2018, the so-called value-based reinforcement learning approach has become quite popular in for this problem, where essentially we first try to estimate the long-term value of assigning one order to one customer, and then try to solve matching problem to maximize the total long-term reward of the whole platform. So that's the background. And in our study and some experiments with real data, we find that one challenge to the so-called value-based reinforcement learning in this problem is the non-stationarity of the environment, which means the dynamic of the whole system and the city will change over time, weekly, week by week. And if we naively merge all data together and use them to estimate the value function, it will bring huge bias to the estimated value function and hence make the performance of our dispatching algorithm degenerate. So in this paper, we are concerned with such a challenge and we try to handle it via the transfer learning framework, where we essentially regard those data generated in some old environments as a so-called source environment. And we try to find a way to reuse them so that on one hand, we can improve our efficiency in the current environment. And on the other hand, we can avoid the bias from a naive immersion. So that's the problem we are concerned with. And the take home message here basically is that we are focused on so-called pattern transfer learning, where we aim to focus on some shared patterns between the old environment and the new environment. Specifically, our paper is motivated by the following observation that is, for example, if we all focus on one specific region, then its absolutely value may change over time. It may become very more and more popular, et cetera. However, the relative relationship between a pair of states will be typically quite stable. For example, there will be some harsh zones or cold versus cold zones. And if you consider time horizon or time dimension, there will be some rush hours versus normal hours. So even though we naively combining these two data sets would lead to some bias, but we can focus on such a stable pattern or relationship and somehow utilize them to improve our efficiency. So the idea would be as follows, that we will try to first estimate and extract such a pattern and then reuse them in our current dispatching platform. So roughly speaking, our contribution can be summarized as the following threefold, that conceptually we propose a so-called pattern transfer learning framework, which to our knowledge is quite novel to even the transfer RL literature, where we focus on some domain-specific structural information and then try to extract them and use them in the target environment. And we also designed a very concrete and efficient transfer RL algorithm for this specific order dispatching problem by focusing on one specific called concordance relationship, which we will define in a few slides. And such an algorithm shows quite promising performance in a well-calibrated simulator. and demonstrate the usefulness of transfer learning. So let's try to formulate the problem a little bit. So our model is a kind of standard model in the literature where we consider the order dispassion problem as a semi-Markov decision process model, where the state of a driver essentially is its location and the time of the day. And the available action would be for an available driver would be either assign an order to him or to ask him or her to stay idle. And the reward for the former action, the reward would be the discounted revenue from that order. And for the later, of course, the reward would be zero. And accordingly, the transition for the former action would lead the driver to the destination location and the end time of the order, which typically is based on some estimates. And for the former, that is, if the driver would stay idling, of course, we assume it will idle around its current location. So that's the rough rate picture, that there are some available drivers, idle around the city. And we aim to find a good policy to, in real time, assign those available orders to those drivers. And so as to maximize the expected long-term reward. So under the value-based framework, we rely on the value function, which heuristically is defined as the expected discounted accumulated reward for a driver, for a random driver starting from that location at that time. So at a high level here, following the literature, we kind of consider a decomposed approach that we focus on each driver kind of as independently, but in some part we also consider them jointly. Such a decomposition will allow us to handle the problem in a much more feasible way. And our main framework is under the quite popular framework, which is called offline policy evaluation plus online order dispatching. As I talked about, we are first to try to use some historical data to estimate the value of each driver order pair, and then use that estimated value function to dispatch orders in an online fashion. So suppose we already got the value function. The order dispatch problem is typically formulated as a bipartite matching problem, where we try to solve this matching problem and that is match each available drivers and to dispatch each orders to each available drivers under certain constraints to maximize the long-term cumulative reward for the platform evaluated by the Q function. So this optimization problem can be typically solved by the popular and standard so-called KM algorithm. In the literature, a standard way to estimate the value function is the dynamic programming, where essentially we estimate in a kind of backpropagate way and calculate some sample mean. However, as we talk about, if we naively combine all available data in this data buffer, it will introduce some bias due to the non-stationarity. So our work will focus on, suppose we have an old data set and a new data set, how to efficiently utilize that old data set. Okay. As we talk about, we will focus on some patterns across these two environments. And specifically, we will focus on the concordance relationship, which is formally defined as follows. Well, intuitively, if the value of one state is higher than another in one environment, then we say the concordance relationship holds if the value of the first state is also higher than the other states in the target environment and vice versa. So essentially the relative relationship between these two states in terms of their values are consistent across the two environments. So yeah, and given such a definition, we can introduce our loss function. With the loss function, we can then introduce some constraint and a penalty and use them to stabilize the whole estimation problem. So given some user-specific distribution over the state pairs, we can define such a loss function, which is essentially the probability that the concordance relationship will be violated. And our assumption would be that the concordance relationship largely holds across the between the old environment and the new environment, so that this loss would be small, and hence we can utilize it as a constraint or penalty. Yeah, that's a heuristic assumption, and according to our observation, it typically holds. So as an example, we are also focused on the concordance relationship along the spatial dimension, that is between some states, for example, hot regions and cold regions. We carefully chose some location pairs, and we believe the concordance relationship will hold between those pairs in such a set. Okay. So given this the definition concordance loss and this assumption, and I recall that the standard way to estimate the value function is the dynamic programming. And by some standard arguments, we can find it's actually equivalent to solve basically minimization problem about the TD error or with a squared loss. So this is the standard problem. And under that assumption, it's quite intuitive to introduce a constraint to the problem. That is, we reformulate the loss function into other concordance loss into a so-called spatial concordance loss based on the pre-specified state pairs. And then we introduce it as a constraint here, in addition to the standard original TD error minimization problem. So under such with such a problem and under our assumption with such a constraint, it should be more stable and efficient than the original problem. And here, yes, maybe we miss some notation here. Here, the data tuple is only contains those data in the new environment, and those data in the old environment has been, extracted and summarized into the concordance loss here. Those V function, VS function is defined as the value function learned from the source environment, that is the old environment. So this is our, the primal form of our problem. However, you will find it's hard to solve that. So naturally we are considering it's a Lagrange dual form, which is a penalizer problem. And we also find that the concordance loss is known to be hard to solve, because it's not differentiable. So the typical way to handle that is to consider a surrogate loss function with the so-called hinge loss as defined here. So finally, we convert the original TD error minimization problem into such a penalized version. And we use the concordance relationship to improve the estimation efficiency. And with such a form, we can make the value function more accurate and hence improve the quality of the whole dispatching system. And to solve the value function, we can simply apply some gradient descent algorithms and with the appropriate chosen step size, we can prove that the optimization problem will converge to the global optimum. So we evaluate our algorithm in a, you know, a real data calibrated simulator where we obtain some you know, drivers and other information from the DD TrueSim platform and construct a simulator following the literature so that the simulated data has very small difference with the observed real data, sorry. And then we'll compare our algorithm with a few baselines. In one word, all of them are some you know, KM algorithm based dispassion algorithm. The only difference lies in how do we estimate their value function. Do we only utilize the data in the old environment or only utilize data in the new environment, which potentially will have some huge variance? Or do we naively combine the two data sources, which will lead to some bias, as we mentioned? And the final one is our pattern transfer algorithm. So with the real data calibrated simulator, we use the first half a month at the source environment and the last half a month at the target environment. And here's our results. We will report the cumulative reward and two other metrics. The higher, the better. And the green one, the blue one is our algorithm. So we observe that you know, the findings are quite consistent with our intuition that our algorithm outperforms the other algorithms by significant margins due to the elegant designed transfer learning framework. And specifically, if you observe the initial several days, it enjoys a jump start. And it's, if you observe the convergence rate, you will find it converges more quickly. And the final performance is also better. All those are some benefits from transfer learning. And if you look at the naively combined approach, for example, the green one, you will find it suffers from the bias and it almost does not improve. And for example, the red one, which is target only, that is we only utilize data in the current environment, you will find it to slowly improve, but due to the variance, it is much slower than ours. Okay. So to sum up in this paper, focusing on the online order dispassion problem, you propose a concordance penalty based transfer learning framework. And there are several directions to extend our work. The first is, of course, in this paper, we consider a classic approach that is the tabular setup, but we can compare or we can consider coupling our proposal with, you know, deep neural network based value function estimator. And as I mentioned, the high level idea of pattern transfer learning is quite novel to the literature. And as long as we can find some, you know, domain-specific patterns, we can consider apply this procedure. For example, we can consider it to other reinforcement learning problem in ITS, and you know, especially there is some spatial structure, and maybe we can find some similar use case. And we can also consider some other, you know, structure other than the concordance relationship based on some domain knowledge. Yeah, this is basically my talk. Thanks so much.
Thanks for that. Thanks. We run a little bit over time, but if there's any quick questions, feel free to post them in the chat. I had one question, and maybe I missed something, but it seems that between the two environments that you're considering, there is some requirement that you can like associate one state in one environment to a state in the other environment. Is that correct? Like in the evaluation of your two value functions, you know, you need to have, in this particular example, it's you have to have an S1 in the source environment and a corresponding S1 in the target environment.
So essentially we are considering two No, the same country or the same city.
Right. So if you were going to try and transfer this to maybe a very different looking road network or something, then would that work well, or would that be a challenge to find these associated states that are correspondents?
Yeah. So on one hand, that would be more challenging than this case, but on the other hand, I think the high-level idea can still be applicable. For example, since we focus on some structural information, like for example, school would be more popular than, I don't know, some hospital, etc. You can try to extract this kind of information and utilize them in another city. That's feasible, I think.
Very, very cool. Fantastic work. Thanks for telling us about it.
Thank you.
Okay, so I think we'll move on to the next spotlight.
Sure.
The next spotlight is a linear programming and prediction-based look-ahead policy for vehicle repositioning in ride-hailing systems. The authors are Hong Hao Wei, Zixian Yang, Zhiwei Qin, and Zhao Cheng Tang and Lei Ying. Do we have Hong Hao is going to be the presenter. Okay, great.
Yeah.
So welcome and feel free to share your screen and take it away.
Okay, thanks, Dan. So can I see my screen?
Yeah, great.
Oh, sure. Okay. So, I'm very glad to here to present our work, linear programming and prediction-based look-ahead policy for vehicle repositioning in ride-hailing systems. My name is Hong Wei, and I'm a PhD student from the University of Michigan. And this is a joint work with Zixian Yang and Tony Qin, Xiaocheng Tang, and my advisor Li. So the past decades have seen the rapid proliferation of ride sharing services. According to the data of the data for the ride hailing platforms in United States only, the revenue has increased from $4 billion in 2015 to $40 billion in 2019. And you may notice the value in 2020 drops significantly because of the pandemic around the world. So let's ignore that number. So the reason behind this huge market is because the emerging of the leading ride hailing companies in this domain, like Lyft, Uber in US, and Didi in China, etc. So then we can say that from the ride hailing platform perspective, an efficient framework or algorithms can bring huge economic benefits. For example, the order dispatching algorithms, as the Runjie just talked, and the repositioning recommendation system, and even the pricing strategies. So in this paper, we focus on vehicle repositioning problem. Sometimes we call it an empty car routing problem as well. So this problem is motivated by the phenomenon that the supply demand imbalance exists in real world. So let's take a look at this figure. So it shows that the demand heat map from the real world data. So the warmer the color is, the higher the demand at that region will be. But higher demand doesn't mean higher supplies as well, right? So we all have such kind of experience, like it's very hard to get a Uber at the airport. And as shown in the other figure, so the vehicle repositioning algorithm aims to design a centralized planner which can route the idle vehicles to a specific location and in anticipation of the future demand at the destination. So it will benefit both the drivers and passengers in long run. So to the drivers, it can improve the incomes obviously and reduce the idle waiting time. So to the passengers, they may have a better experience in terms of the pickup distance and the order response rate. So the platform needs to pay attention to, and it raises the question naturally, how to design a data-driven, reliable, trustworthy repositioning algorithm while fulfilling most passengers' requests, or the completion rate for short. So there are some difficulties and existing work related to this problem. The first one, the first difficulty is the highly dynamic environment. The reason is the limited supply and the asymmetric demand across time and spaces. So the reason, like for example, other irregular events like the musical concerts or sports games occurrences during a short period of time around a local area. In that case, there's a peak demand request at a certain moment. So one approach to address this dynamic system is using the linear programming methods. For example, Braverman and Apache or the Veller, they have some networks modeling this problem as an LP. The reason the repositioning task is somehow similar to the queuing network. So like for example, each region is a single server station where the vehicles are considered as jobs and assigning passengers to red to add drivers corresponding to the completion rate. And then this is straightforward to model the repositioning algorithm using LP method. But the drawback is they assume the system is already in steady state and can only generate a short-term repositioning policy due to the highly randomness and dynamic of the system. So they ignore the long-term returns. On the contrary, due to the significant success of IL algorithms, some existing works like the Liu and Haller and the Zhou, they apply the IL algorithms on repositioning problems as well. And they achieve greater improvement, but this method will be problematic when the controllable fraction of vehicles becomes larger. For example, like they crowd a large fleet of vehicles into a single location with higher value, but that can cause an undesirable imbalance. Then in light of these limitations, we are trying to design a practical algorithm considering the highly dynamic of the environment and long-term returns simultaneously, right? So we follow the work by Braverman and we model this problem as a LP with multiple step look ahead as well as a learn the value function. The objective contains two parts. Let's say the first part in the yellow box is average order answering rate. And we remark here that the lambda I is the arrival rate. And we use the LSTM CNN-based prediction method which use the contextual features as input, including like the locations, the times, and the neighbors informations to perfectly capture spatial temporal prediction to predict the arrival rate. And we also have some other parameters, including the LP, such as the transition probability, the travel time. We just use the estimated value calculated from the offline data. And the second term in the blue box represents the expected discounted total reward from the time afterward. Then we can easily say this can be trained offline using the modern IL algorithms based on the historical data. And also in order to have a formal LP, we also need to have constraints. As we mentioned previously, the repositioning task is quite similar to the queuing network. Then the constraints are just defined on the car flows balance equation. For example, for a specific region, we have the inflows, outflows, and we need to balance the flows to make the solution feasible. So I omit the details and please refer to our paper if you are interested. And for this, the constraints, the contributions we made here is first, we introduced the controllable fraction factor, which is ignored by the previous works. The reason is simple. So like we cannot assume that every driver will accept the repositioning recommendations, and they may have their own personalities, their own preferences. And the second change we made is to relax constraint to capture the non-stationary system constraints, which is also always true in practice. So we cannot expect the system is already in the steady state, right? So then the output from by solving this LP is the transition matrix QIG, which simply indicates the probability our routing algorithm which reputation the idle driver from the region A to the region G. So after introducing the model, I'd like to talk about the pipeline. So as illustrated in the figure. So we first divide the whole day into a discrete time slot. Each time slot indicates a time interval. So we use the 10 minutes in our simulation. And we first train a value function from the historical trajectory data, which is done totally offline. And so I believe the audience are already familiar with style. So I was trying to find a policy via trial and error to maximize the long-term reward. And lots of works, even in today's talk, use the algorithms, and which are very powerful and flexible in practice. So then at each time slot, we first predict the passenger arrival rate over the future T time slots using the neural network considering the spatial temporal correlation. And then our method generates a repositioning policy by solving the LP with a predicted arrival rate and other estimated parameters. Finally, the centralized planner sends the repositioning recommendations to each driver. Then the system continues until the end of the day. So then in the following part, I will talk the simulation environment and what is the performance of our algorithm and as well as some interesting observations. And so we design a bunch of extensive experiments on a grid map system, which is shown in the figure at the left-hand side. And the locations are chosen from the real-world data, and the orders are also sampled from the real trajectory data as well. And it can capture the real-life supply demand at each region. And the other figure is the illustration of the repositioning process by our algorithm at some time slot. So the green arrows represent the repositioning direction, and the colors, each colors represent different level of the demand of the corresponding grid. As we can see in this figure, the algorithm may not always reposition cars from a low demand to a region to a high, from a region to a higher one. So it highly depends on the current and future distributions of the idle drivers and arrivals. So that's why we need a centralized planner to optimize this problem from big picture. That may hurt the income of an individual driver, but it will improve the benefits for all the drivers in the system in the long run. Then, so let's see some simulation results. The first one is in the first figure, we investigate the influence of controllable fractions on the total order completion rates. So the order completion rate will increase when the controllable fraction increases until the saturation point, like for example, the 0.4 for our algorithm. And we also observe that there's a job for only using IL method as the fraction increase. That's what I mean. So the IL algorithms will be problematic if not considering the traffic pattern from the whole system perspective. In the second figure, we are looking at the different look ahead policies, the impact of the different look ahead policies on the performance. So that means we cannot plan so much steps. Maybe for our problem, like the 20% planning is a perfect time window. So then let's say the second simulation in this one, we are trying to show the influence of the total number of vehicles on the performance. So the compilation rate increased when the number of vehicles increased for all the algorithms. So in fact, the number of vehicles represent the supply power of the system. And there's an obvious supply demand interval, for example, from 3,000 to the 5,000, this interval. Like the repositioning algorithm will have a significant gain. This observation is consistent with our intuitions. Like when the number of vehicles is large, that means the supply is enough. So there's no need to do the repositioning at all. And all the algorithms can have a reasonable good performance. But on the contrary, when the number of vehicles is small, like the supply is rare, so there's also no need to do the repositioning since roughly all the vehicles are busy all the time and there are no idle drivers in the system. So this indicates like there exists a traffic regime in which the repositioning algorithm plays a significant role. This question is interesting because if we, in general, we found our algorithm doesn't have the obvious improvements compared with other baselines, that may be the reason like we are looking at the wrong regime. So in the second figure, we check the robustness of our algorithm by varying the noise level of the railways in the system. And we can say our algorithm can still achieve a completion rate as high as 0.187 and a high level of noise. And so in the last simulation, we would like to discuss the problem. If the LP has multiple optimal solutions or suboptimal solutions, so we would like to choose the one which repositions the cars to a closer area, since the drivers would like to reduce the fuel cost and the drivers would be annoyed if the system really repositioned them to a very far away area. So I'll consider the situation like each completed repositioning consumes a bit of budget as an incentive bonus. So the budget is limited, so we cannot, we want to limit the repositioning distance. So what we can do is by make a slightly change to the original objective by further adding a fuel cost penalty to the objective function. And so, and also the objective function is also linear. So then we got a new LP solution on this new objective function. And so as we can see, like adding the fuel cost to the objective function can save lots of the travel cost. Let's say compares the black curve and the red curve, there's a significant drop in terms of fuel cost, but well, they can maintain the similar completion rate. So that's all the for today's talk. So any questions? Yeah.
Thank you. This is very interesting work. If anyone has any questions, feel free to type them into the chat. Again, we are a little bit over time. We had a question from Jiawei Wang. Thanks for the interesting presentation. I would like to ask a question. Does the prediction module depend on the policy from the agents?
Yeah, actually, if you change the repositioning policy or the dispatch policy, the arrival rate may different. The arrival rate will be the same. Like we only predict the arrival rate for the regions. That depends on the, for example, the weather, the day of the, if it is a holiday or not. It doesn't depend on the policy, like the dispatching policy or the repetition policy, yeah.
Do you have some plans to actually deploy the system? I wonder if the assumptions about what percentage of the time drivers will actually take the recommendations will be true, and it also seems like that will have a huge impact on the performance of the system, like whether the drivers decide to take the recommendations or not, right?
Yeah. So that's that's why we consider the fraction rate. It captures the probability, like the driver would accept the repositioning recommendation or not. So we actually did some simulation on a more complex platform, like the used in the KDD computation. We have some results, but it's not included in the paper. We can increase the completion rate by 1%. I think that means a lot for the company. Yeah, because we use that simulation, like the map is very huge. It includes 1,000 grids, and the traffic pattern follows the real world traffic patterns. And I think what we saw in the simulation results, we don't need to set the fraction rate to be very high, like 0.4 or 0.3. That's enough for improving the completion rate, and of course for the salaries for the drivers. Yeah,
very cool. Yeah. All right, thanks again.
Thank you.
We'll move on to the third spotlight talk of the session, which is UAVs for Search and Rescue, a Reinforcement Learning Approach. Authors are Laren Chang, Piki Wang, Dinghao Ma, Mohamed Degani, Mehdi Beruzzi, and Emmanuel Melakrinoudis.
Nice try. That was good. Close enough.
I try my best. There's quite some diversity on this team. Mohamed is going to present the work, I gather. So take it away.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Liam, for the introduction. And thank you so much for those of you who organized this workshop. It's amazing to be part of this workshop and present the work that we did all together as a group. This is Mohamed Degani from Mechanical and Industrial Engineering Department at Northeastern University in Boston. And I'm here on behalf of our wonderful group, Laren, Peichi, and Dinghao, our PhD students who were part of this project, and two of my colleagues, Dr. Beruzzi and Dr. Melakrinoudis, who also supported this project for us. And as you can see, you're talking about the UAV search and rescue kind of operation based on the reinforcement learning approach. To start, like UAVs have a lot of advantages to help the human for search and rescue operations, especially for disaster scenarios, and people have limitations to do the search. Like UAVs would be a perfect substitute to explore the areas and send the data to the human facilities to facilitate the operations to save lives. So on those operations or those situations, and human would really have limited access or would be dangerous for human to be involved. So UAVs would be a perfect, tool to be used. And also, in addition to their advantages, with the technology and the cameras and sensoring kind of capabilities that they have, they could easily communicate with the people, transfer the data, and also support the search and rescue operations. And also, you can have a fleet of UAVs that cooperate together and search a large area in a faster way. So these are all just some examples of how great the UAVs are and how they are getting more attention for helping the human to be involved with the search and rescue operation. However, I'm just, even our kind of examples are mainly focused on search and rescue, but you can kind of relate the idea to the delivery and some other applications of UAVs. On the other hand, even though I just mentioned some of the great advantages, there's a big challenge for the UAVs, and that's basically the limitation for the battery capacity. So UAVs cannot really go for a long time and do the long operations. So because of the battery limitations that they have, and that is kind of an obstacle, because you really do not want the UAV to go out of battery or fail the operation. So what we are kind of considering and offering as a kind of a solution approach is just adding a charging station. So we assume that there are some charging stations as the people recharge their cars, and the UAVs can visit and recharge their battery and can continue the operation to make it more efficient. So this efficiency can basically come from either do the further operation after get recharged, and also visiting more service nodes to collect more rewards. So this is basically the idea, and we are trying to solve this problem based on reinforcement learning. So if I want to kind of discuss the problem, we have a service area with some service nodes. As you can see the circles are indicating the service nodes, and some of them are highlighted, some of them are kind of faded out. And that means because you are dealing with a kind of orienting problem where you just visit a subset of service nodes and not all of those. So it's very important to know which node to visit and which one to not to visit, or in other words, prioritizing kind of the service nodes to collect the maximum possible reward in the time horizon. And the other important thing here is what's the best route, and finally adding the charging station. So all of the UAVs basically depart from the hub, and they need to explore the whole area and pick the nodes that can, you know, gives the model the most possible reward, and finally get back to hub when the time horizon is over. So if I want to kind of highlight the important questions that we need to answer, first thing is the node selection, which nodes to serve to kind of solve the orienting problem. And then the routing is important. The sequence that each UAV is going to visit those nodes is also important. And finally, what's going to be the best time, or what's going to be the optimal kind of situation that the UAV needs to visit those charging stations to recharge its battery. So if you look at the existing works in the literature, obviously optimization is, you know, was, you know, has been there for a long time, and people try to solve the model based on different optimization techniques and exact methods, and also heuristics. If you dig the literature, you can see some papers even added the time window, which means like every single node might have, you know, the lowest, the earliest and the latest, you know, time to be visited. Otherwise, you know, the model can get penalized. Even the battery duration was also one of the limitations, some heuristic papers in the literature. But as I told you, like as I mentioned earlier, we are offering or just kind of contributing a reinforcement learning model that not only including and considering the time window and also battery duration, but also adding one more layer of complexity to the model, which based on charging stations, that kind of enables the model to decide what, you know, what's going to be the best time to visit, and also how it can collect more rewards based on that capability. So to solve this based on reinforcement learning, we obviously need to define our MDP model. The state is defined based on three factors in this problem. First, location. Obviously, if I have a grid of, for example, 100 by 100, the specific specifications and location of the UAV at any point is important for us. And this is one kind of element. The other one is remaining time, since we have a time window restriction for each of the nodes, and also a time horizon to complete the whole model and trip. The remaining time is also an important factor for the state definition, plus the battery level, which determines you know, how the agent decides to visit the charging stations. All of those are kind of, at least the first two are continuous variables, but down the road, we figured out like it's better and would be more efficient to discretize them. So even though the values are continuous, but location and remaining time somehow have been discretized to solve the model. For the action, there are basically three actions for any agent or any UAV throughout this reinforcement learning run. The first thing is whether to visit a service node or not. And if it decides to visit a service node, which service node to visit. Or it may decide to visit charging station or visiting the hub to finish the whole trip. So these are basically the train main decisions or actions that any agent can make throughout the whole episode to complete the run. And we decided to set the reward based on these three factors. So if the drone or UAV decides to visit a service node, it gets a positive reward. If it decides to visit, you know, a charging station, it gets zero. But it, you know, it can improve its battery life. And if this it fails to complete the trip, which means like if it goes out of the battery, or if could not provide a feasible solution, that means if we cannot complete the trip within the time horizon or time windows, it gets a negative reward. So this is how the model kind of set, you know, settled up for this problem. And also to complete this, we added two, I can say, novelty items to the solution algorithm that we are using. So the first one is non-decreasing tree search, or NDTS, and the other one is cluster first and the routing second. So I'm going to explain them in details in here. This is the pseudocode of Q-letting, nothing different than Q-letting, but we just added a few new kind of items in here. The first thing is, as I told you, non-decreasing tree, that basically means that if the current decision or current action of the agent is not improving the old reward, we do not update the Q value. So we just want to make sure that the action is taken is in the right direction that kind of can give us the best reward possible, at least improve the reward at any given time. And the second thing is we always use experience to play to improve the efficiency of the model. And the last thing is the masking for the actions, because there's a limitation that if any node is visited, we no longer need to visit that service node. Obviously, charging station can be visited multiple times, but the service nodes no longer needs to be selected by the agent. So we added this masking to the model. And the rest is just based on the Q-learning model. To move forward, the other thing we just also did, we added kind of heuristic to this. We found that the model by itself would be very kind of hard or difficult to be solved. And in order to improve its efficiency, we decided to cluster nodes, and then we solved each of those problems independently from each other based on, you know, either the optimization or reinforcement learning algorithm. So if I assume this is a sample example of the problem, we have some nodes that are clustered. And so the first thing, we're going to put them in a cluster together based on the location or some other factors. And then the model tries to figure out what's going to be the best routing part of that. So we use the same algorithm for each of those clusters, but these two clusters are somehow independently solved to find the answer. And we did some sort of experiment analysis to understand how our model is performing, and just kind of proof of concept to see if the reinforcement learning is capable of solving such a complex and hard problem. The first thing we did was we designed three levels for the service nodes, SUNY, 50, and 100, to play around with different scales and size of the model. And the second one was considering different charging stations, 2, 5, and 10. And we used multiple approaches, like exact optimization solution methods, plus Q-learning and DQN. I need to mention that, like, even though we combine all of those factors, but just showing and some important results in here. And the exact optimization solution is basically for us as a baseline. We wanted to show how the model is performing, reinforcement learning compared to the exact solution methods. Therefore, we formulated the whole problem into Groovy, and the objective was obviously finding the maximized reward, and reward is just the most collected possible service nodes that we could visit. And the constraints here are pretty straightforward, like we don't want to visit service nodes more than one. We can visit charging stations more than one. We have to make sure that the early, the visiting time for a service node is between its early late time window, and so on. And that was a kind of baseline for us to see how the reinforcement learning model is performing. This is the first result that I'm showing to you. And as you can see, we're still using Q-learning, and it shows that how Q-learning kind of converges to the optimal solution. The red line on the top is the global optimal by the Groovy, and the other three are our Q-learning model, and that's modeled in Python. And as you can see, almost for the 20 and 50, the solution converges, but when we have this with size of 100, still it lacks, and we still have this some kind of optimality gap for the model to solve this scale of the problem. And at the same time, I also wanted to see whether masking helps or not. As I told you, we started not using mask, and therefore we're getting too many infeasible solutions. So we were kind of wasting the computation power. So we found maybe adding a masking could help and enable the agent to learn faster. And it's also shown in here that yes, with masking, we get the convergence quicker compared to the our original approach. On the second kind of scenario, we also tried to use DQN. I think this is based on 50 service nodes. And as you can see here, it shows the DQN is outperforming the actual Q-learning. That shows that maybe the DQN might be a better approach when this problem size gets increased and with larger scales. When the Q-learning or tabular methods may not perform well, DQN would be a good alternative to solve the model. And finally, we did kind of comprehensive analysis to see how different situations with different models can be compared. As you can see on the left side, we have the model with different size and node sizes, like 20, 50, 100. On the upper side, we have number of UAVs, or in other words, the number of clusters that we have. The first thing we found that like the optimality gap is pretty minimal when the problem size is not too big, like almost zero for most cases. And as you can see here, we have three methods, the Groovy one, which is the baseline, and the other one is clustering plus Groovy. So we do clustering, then we send it to Groovy to solve. And the CFRS is our method, clustering first, routing second method. So and you see those size, that means the optimal solutions found by Groovy. And as you can see, for a small size problem, almost reinforcement learning could, you know, find the optimal solution, which is perfect. But when the model becomes larger, when we add the number of UUVs, the complexity gets increased. So there are some optimality gaps in other problems. But it's interesting when the when we have the cluster size of three, Groovy fails to find or provide us the optimal solution. So we have the reward values, but we are not sure whether these are kind of optimal values or not. And therefore, it's kind of interesting that reinforcement learning even could find a better solution in a reasonable time. So therefore, you can see the optimality gap is a negative. That means the solution found from the reinforcement learning is somehow better than the optimal solution provided by the baseline model in Groovy. Also in terms of service time, the computation time, you can see in most cases, the reinforcement learning could find the solution a faster time. So this is, again, this is the proof of concept that how reinforcement learning can substitute with the optimization techniques. And again, this is the beginning. We're still in considering expanding the work and considering other methods. So if I can just summarize the work, we're just solving a team orienting problem of UAVs visiting some service nodes by adding charging stations to extend the reliability of the UAVs and also collect more rewards to serve more customers or more nodes. And in some optimization that does exist, we're also offering or proposing reinforcement learning approach to solve that. And we found that in most cases, the RL converges to the optimal solution and has less computation power, and also DQM would be a better approach for larger scale size problems. The future extension of this work, we basically considering maybe using some other reinforcement learning approaches, maybe adding a more advanced layers to the to our neural network, and also kind of considering other applications, or maybe changing around with the a number of charging stations, location of charging stations, etc. So that was pretty quick and brief presentation of our work, and I would happy to take any questions if you have any.
Thanks so much for telling us about it. We have a question from Tony. The problem setting reminds me of the vehicle routing problem with electric cars. Have you tried or do you plan to generalize your method to that problem?
Thank you so much. Yeah, Tony. Yeah, I think, yeah, absolutely. As I told you, probably this could be somehow applicable to the other generalized models. The reason we started UAVs because you thought, okay, we're going to focus on research and rescue, but down the road, you found this model probably can be generalized, but obviously this would be a great recommendation for us. To make it more generic for the future use.
Yeah, it sounds to me like, yeah, some of the contributions, like the divide and conquer kind of approach, could probably be generalized quite easily to other traveling salesman type problems.
Sure.
Yeah, so that's great.
Thank you.
Yeah, so, okay, so thanks again for the great talk, Mohammed. And with that, I'll close this session. A note also from Tony in the chat that the posters for these presented papers are displayed outside the virtual room, yellow 3 in the conference platform. And so we're going to break now, but everyone's encouraged to go and check out the posters. And so, yeah, with that, we're heading to break now. And I think this we reconvene at 7:15 Eastern time, which is a little under 3 hours from now, 2 hours and 45 minutes. Thanks to all the presenters for presenting their great work and to all the participants for joining the session. And we'll see you later on in the day. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much.